Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
The other example, again related to chemical engineering, is that from that related to process intensification. This whole concept of process intensification is about getting reactions done or processes done at very small scale. The objective again, or the reason again, is that at very small scales you have the energy mass and reaction efficiencies are extremely high. So this picture, for example, is of a micro reactor where you have feed that is coming in from the top, and this is a rotating micro reactor where the reaction takes place. You see that there is this rotating device and the product is formed. Now, because it happens at very small scale and the particle sizes, the bubble or the phase sizes are very small, you again get extremely high heat and mass transfer rates, and the reaction rates are also high, and therefore you can get conversions very fast or very much higher conversions. So this is the concept of process intensification, and this again would fit with the concept of with this particular principle of green engineering, which focuses on maximizing the mass, energy, space and time efficiencies. Now I would like to mention one point here, that in both these examples, whether it's microfluidics or process intensification, at an individual equipment level this would be very efficient, but in an engineering system we also have to worry about the capacities or the production targets. So if you have a micro reactor such as the one shown in this figure, the each micro reactor itself is very efficient, but because it is very small in size, the capacity is also very low. So you are going to need maybe tens or hundreds of these micro reactors at the same time. So a conventional approach is to have a large single reactor, maybe several hundred meter cube, and where you have the reaction going on, but that kind of a setup doesn't give you very high mass and energy transfer rates. The other option is similar to the one shown here, where you have maybe hundreds of these micro reactors connected together or in parallel, where the reaction is happening. So the point I am making is that if you are using these kind of solutions, you need to worry about the scale-up aspects. In order to achieve the desired production levels, you may have to have hundreds of these units together, which also increases the cost of manufacturing, the cost of operating, because you have to manage all these equipments together and so on. So that is a more operational challenge related to implementing this principle. Before I talk about the fifth principle, let me talk about the very popular concept in reaction engineering, that is the Lee-Chatelier's principle. So I have shown here on the slide an irreversible reaction, so A and B giving C and D, and there is an equilibrium, there is a rate at which A and B are converted to C and D. Now let's say C is the desired product, D is the byproduct. Now in order to push this reaction forward, in order to make sure that you have more and more C and D formed and the reaction rate is higher, you have two options. One is to add more A and B so that your equilibrium is pushed towards right, or the second option is to remove C and D as they are formed, because then you can your quantity of C and D is low, the equilibrium will be pushed forward. So the Lee-Chatelier's principle basically says that the equilibrium is a function of the quantity. So if you have a lot of A and B, the equilibrium will be pushed forward. If you have very little C and D, the equilibrium again will be pushed forward. The question I have for you is, which is a better option? Is it better to add A and B, or is it better to remove C and D? So again, if possible, pause this video for some time, think about this problem, and then we will move ahead and see the actual green engineering principle. So I hope you have thought about this. Now, one option is if I can keep adding A and B as was the first option. What is the problem with that option? First of all, because you are adding more and more A and B, your reactor size will increase. So your capital investment will go up. Secondly, you will have to purchase more A and B, so your cost will go up. Now, a lot of that A and B will not be converted into the product, so you'll have to have a recycle system set up. So adding A and B is probably not a good option. The second option is to remove C and D. Now, what happens here? If you keep removing C and D, the concentration of C and D in the reactor will be low at most times, which will ensure that the equilibrium is pushed forward. The reactor size will go down, and you will also not need so much A and B. Now, of course, how to get this done is a different matter. You'll have to ensure that it is physically possible to remove C and D while the reaction is going on, and it's not a straightforward thing. But purely from if I think from the size of the reactor or the material use point standpoint, removing C and D continuously is a better option. So the principle of the next principle, the fifth principle of green engineering, is related to this concept. And the statement says that products, processes and systems should be output pulled rather than input pushed through the use of energy and materials. So going back to the example, if I keep adding more and more A and B, that is like having an input pushed system. I'm adding more input so that the equilibrium shifts towards right. Output pulled is when I'm continuously reducing C and D so that the equilibrium is pulled towards the output side. So the principle says that it is better to have an output pulled system rather than input pushed system. Another example, another situation where this is very relevant is in supply chains. So when you are having large supply chains for products, one option is to keep producing a lot of material, have huge inventories whenever at various locations, have those inventories stocked so that when the product is in demand or when the product is required by the consumer, it is available. But this means that you need to manufacture a lot of material, you need to maintain inventory, maybe the inventory has to be is like a cold storage, so the cost and energy consumption again goes up. Plus you run the risk of the product becoming obsolete. So if the product is suddenly not in demand anymore, all the manufacturing and the inventory you have invested in is not used. The other option is to have a supply chain that depends on the demand for the product. So you might have heard of things like just-in-time delivery, where the idea is whenever the demand is there, that's when you develop your supply chain such that you are able to respond quickly, you manufacture, you quickly deliver it to the consumer, so that you don't have to maintain a lot of inventory. So this is an example of an output pull system, just-in-time delivery. The principle basically says that it is better to have output pull systems because in general it reduces the material and energy investment. So we will look at the remaining principles of green engineering in the next video. So I will continue the discussion on the principles of green engineering. The previous video was on the first five principles of green engineering. In this video, I will cover the rest of the principles. So just a recap, green engineering principles are design guidelines that you can use. These are not rules or laws, but these are suggestions or guidelines that you can use in an engineering problem. We have already looked at these five principles of green engineering, looking at different aspects such as risk minimization by eliminating hazard, preventing waste, minimizing energy consumption and material use, maximizing mass and energy, space and time efficiency, as well as having products and processes that are output pulled. So I will continue with the discussion of the remaining principles now. The fifth, the next principle, the sixth principle of green engineering is about the, is related to the issue of reuse, recycle, and so on. So, very often the terms reuse and recycle are used interchangeably, but that is not true. They have different meanings. If you look at the issue, or if you look at the concept of recycling or waste management, this particular pyramid is very famously shown. So here, whatever is at the top is the most preferred option, and as you go from top to bottom, you encounter less and less preferred options. So the best option is to eliminate waste. If you are able to eliminate waste, and one of the green engineering principles actually talks about eliminating waste, that is the best option. If you cannot do that, then minimizing waste is the best option, the next best. After that, the next option is to have reuse. If you cannot reuse, then you recycle. If you cannot even recycle, then you look for energy recovery, and finally disposal. So this is the sequence in which you prioritize the ways to handle waste. Now this particular principle is related to the concept of reuse and recycle, or reuse versus recycle. I want to explain this principle by discussing two different examples. The first one is related to plastic products. What you see on the slide are two different products made out of plastic. On the left, you have a PET bottle, such as the one that we use for water or soft drink and so on. On the right, you have a water purifier, in which most of the parts are made up of some kind of a plastic material. So there could be multiple plastic types that are used, so HDPE, LDPE, PET and so on, but all of this is made of plastic. And let us assume that both of these products are not usable anymore. So the plastic bottle has been used, it has been opened and being used by someone, and let's say that this water purifier is not usable anymore because it is not working, it is not doing the job. Now question to you is, which one of these will you reuse and which one of these will you recycle? So if it is possible, please pause this video and try to think of your preference, which product should be reused, which product should be recycled. I hope you have made up your mind. Let me ask another example. So this is about utilization of biomass. So let us say you have biomass such as agriculture residue, which is to be used. Now there are different ways you can use this biomass. First, a very simple way is to do thermal treatment. And within thermal treatment also, the most basic operation is combustion. You can simply burn the biomass and you can possibly produce some energy out of it. So you burn biomass in a boiler, you generate steam, and the steam can be used for some application. You can also use some more complicated thermal treatments like gasification, pyrolysis and so on, which produce a different set of products. So gasification will produce gaseous products like methane, carbon monoxide, hydrogen and so on. Pyrolysis typically produces gas, liquid oil, which is known as bio oil, and char. But these are basically all thermal treatments. So that is one category of treatments. The second category is chemical treatment, where you do some kind of catalytic process. Again, the objective could be to get gas or bio oil as product. And on the third option is to do biological treatment, and here you have options like enzymatic hydrolysis, fermentation, some kind of microbial treatment, which gives you fuels and platform chemicals. So you can have either fuels like ethanol, butanol that are produced using biomass, or you can also produce platform molecules like lactic acid, succinic acid, levulinic acid, xylitol and so on. So the question is, if you want to use biomass, which is a better option? Is it better to do thermal treatment and get energy, or is it better to do biological treatment and get these platform chemicals? So again, think about it, and while you are making this decision, please ignore aspects like cost of conversion, the demand for products and so on. So let us ignore all those aspects. The question is purely from the biomass utilization perspective. If you have biomass available, which is the best option to utilize that biomass? So again, if possible, pause this video, think about it, and then we will move ahead. So the next principle is actually, as I said, it relates to reuse versus recycle. And the principle itself says that the embedded complexity in a material must be viewed as an investment when making design choices on the recycle, reuse, or beneficial disposal. Now let me go back to the two examples and explain this. So in the first example, there are two products, and I want you to focus on the complexity aspect, because the principle talks about the embedded complexity in the material. So the question here is, which is a more complex product? And there is no question that this particular water purifier is a more complex product, because it has multiple parts, different shapes, sizes, different types of plastic materials possibly. The PET bottle, on the other hand, is just a single type of plastic, and it's a very simple design. There is not much complexity in it. So as per the green engineering principle, if this is a dysfunctional product, it has embedded complexity. So you should look at it as a, you should take advantage of that complexity. So it doesn't make sense to send all of this purifier for recycling, because it's quite possible that some of these parts are still usable. So it's better to disassemble this particular product, take out whatever is usable, and reuse those components as much as possible, and the rest you send for recycle. The bottle, on the other hand, maybe from hygiene perspective and so on, the best option is to recycle, and it is not very complicated, and therefore recycle is actually a good option. Let me talk about the biomass example. Now, biomass, if you are familiar with the structure of biomass, biomass consists of different polymers of glucose and sucrose. So the biomass has three different main components: cellulose, hemicellulose, and lignin. Cellulose is a polymer of glucose. Hemicellulose is a polymer of carbon 5 and carbon 6 sugars, mainly carbon 5. And there is lignin, which also consists of complex biological molecules. So if you are burning biomass, you are actually completely destroying all that complexity. So biomass is a very complex material, and nature, through the process of photosynthesis, has put in a lot of effort to make this complex material. But when you burn or do a thermal treatment, you are basically destroying all that complexity to get very basic molecules out. On the other hand, if I am using biological treatment, let's say enzymatic or microbial treatment, to get platform chemicals like lactic acid and so on, you are depolymerizing it, but you are still maintaining some complexity of the original material. And purely from a green engineering perspective, that is a desirable thing to do, because all the efforts that nature has put in to make this complex biomass material, you are preserving that complexity and taking advantage of that complexity to produce something that is usable. In this example, in this route, you are actually destroying everything. So all the efforts that have gone in to make that complex material are wasted. So coming back to the principle, the recommendation from that principle is that if you have a material which has high complexity, then you should always look for opportunities to reuse it as much as possible. In contrast, if you have material which has low complexity, of course reuse is always better than recycle, but if reuse is not possible, it is okay to recycle or maybe dispose. So whenever you are dealing with any material that is coming out as waste, this is a principle that you should think about. Is the product or the material complex? Does it have embedded complexity? If yes, look for reuse opportunities. Maybe not for the whole product, but for the different components of the product. If it has low complexity, maybe recycle and disposal is better. again, I want to emphasize that this ignores the technical feasibility. If I go back to the biomass example, it is much easier to perform combustion, pyrolysis and gasification as compared to some of these biological or enzymatic treatments. So this route is much more complicated. In many cases, it is not economically feasible, but we are ignoring all those issues as of now. The next principle of green engineering relates to packaging. Packaging is actually a big issue these days because a lot of purchasing is now happening online. And I'm sure you at some point have ordered something online, and when you order it online, it comes with packaging. And that is necessary because you want to make sure, or the person or the company which is selling the product wants to make sure that the product reaches you without any damage. So packaging does have a does serve a purpose. But what happens to the packaging after we get the product? Once the package is delivered, once the product is delivered, typically the packaging material goes as waste. In case of cardboard, still there is some recycle depending on how you manage. But if you have plastic packaging, for example, bubble wraps or packaging that comes on food items, it is unfortunately not reused or recycled very well. A lot of it is going as waste to landfills. So it's a big problem. So the principle of green engineering, the seventh principle, talks about targeted durability. So it says that targeted durability and not immortality should be the design goal. So whenever you are manufacturing something, don't target durability, or don't target immortality, but target durability, or in other words, it should serve the purpose of protecting the product up to the point it is needed. But beyond that, the packaging material or the packaging material is not needed. So some examples of this are, for example, eatable cutlery. So this picture here, which is taken from this particular website, shows that you can have a coffee cup which is made of a biscuit like material. Once you drink coffee, you can actually eat the coffee cup also. A similar example which is very common is getting ice cream in a cone versus a cup. When you eat ice cream in a cone, the cone is a container for ice cream, but once you are done eating ice cream, you can also eat the cone, so you are not generating any waste. But if you are using cup instead, you are generating paper waste. It may have some plastic lining from inside, so you are generating some waste. There are eatable cutlery also there, so there are some companies that are producing spoons and forks and so on, which can be eaten. So once you are done eating your food, you can actually eat the spoon and the rest of the cutlery, even plates. So that's an example of targeted durability. Moving away from food products, if I go back to the packaging example that I gave, if you expect that the package requires, let's say, about 3 to 4 weeks to be delivered to the consumer, then you need a packaging material that can do its job for that particular duration of 3 to 4 weeks. Beyond that, the packaging material is not really needed. So maybe you can have a packaging material that biodegrades, and after 3 to 4 weeks it will start biodegrading on its own, and by that time it would have served its purpose. So that's again an example of targeted durability and instead of immortality. So you need to go back and think some of the design the product design to ensure that you have targeted durability. The next principle, before I introduce the next principle, let me talk about the HVAC system, so heating, ventilation and air conditioning systems. So if you have gone to any hall, or any, let's say, cinema hall or a restaurant where the air conditioner is working, I'm sure you have encountered situations where the temperature was too low, it was too cold for you. or maybe you have gone to a particular building where, like a shopping mall, where everything is centralized. So there is a centralized heating or cooling system, and in some cases it becomes too hot, in some cases it becomes too cold. So this is a very common problem with centralized heating and cooling systems, that for some people it's too hot, for some people it's too cold. Let me give you another example. This example relates to washing detergent in US. So when you are using washing detergent for clothes, it has to work with the quality of water that is available in the region, and hardness of water is one of the issues that you need to handle. So if you have water that is that is harder, that means hardness is more, then the formulation of the detergent has to change in order to handle the hardness of the water. What I have shown here, this picture shows is the average hardness for different regions of the US. So red color indicates the water has more hardness, light blue or purple color indicates that the water has less hardness. What this basically shows is that the hardness varies from region to region in the US, and that is expected for any region. Now a detergent manufacturing company, a washing detergent manufacturing company, should take this into account while designing the while providing the water the washing detergent to different regions. So one possibility is that the company can manufacture the detergent that can take care of the worst case of hardness. So this is the region where the hardness is the worst. So they can come up with a formulation that can take care of this hardness, and everybody in the country is supplied the same detergent, and that will work purely from washing perspective, that will work. But for these regions where the water hardness is not so high, that will be an over design. The formulation is actually accounting for hardness which is not encountered in these particular regions. So for those cases it's an over design. So these two examples essentially talk about this approach of one size fits all. So when you have a centralized heating, ventilation and air conditioning system, you are trying to come up with a system that that is centralized and assumes that one size fits all. Similarly, if I am formulating a detergent which is designed for worst case of hardness, again I am actually coming up with a product which is following the one size fits all concept. So the particular principle of green engineering says that design for unnecessary capacity or capability, or in other words, this one size fits all approach should be considered a design flaw. So if you have a heating or cooling system, air conditioning system that is centralized, yes, it is simpler to operate, and that's why in many cases it is implemented, but it is not the most efficient because you are using this one size fits all. Perhaps a better approach is to have localized heating and cooling systems which can be modulated, changed as and when necessary. So if the number of people in a particular room has gone up, you can modify the cooling system. If the number of people in the room is low, you can again change it. That will obviously ensure that everybody is comfortable, and also the energy consumption goes down. Of course, it's much more complicated to operate that kind of a system, but again, purely from green engineering perspective, that's a desirable thing. Going back to the detergent example, a solution is to make formulations that work with different hardness. So you have one formulation that works for hard water, one formulation that works for soft water, and so on. But of course, you will have to ensure that you are sending the right product to the right region, and that means there will be some additional work related to managing supply chains, inventory, and so on. So this is the principle, the eighth principle of green engineering, and that is to avoid one size fits all approach in designing. For the next principle, let me go back to the problem of plastics. Now, we all of us know that plastic processing or plastic waste management is a huge issue. And this is a typical picture that you will find in any waste collection facility. You have different kinds of plastics. Now, if you purely think about the process options that are available to treat plastic, we do have options available. So, we have pyrolysis, we can do gasification, we can have different kinds of pyrolysis. So, it's not that we don't have options to treat plastic. But the problem is, you have such a variety of plastics that none of these processes can operate efficiently, because the plastic comes in a mixed form and it is not easy to separate plastics into different categories such as PVC, HDP, LDP, PET and so on. And because everything is mixed, the processes don't work efficiently and therefore they are not successful when it comes to implementation. So the next principle is actually related to this problem of material diversity. So the principle says that material diversity in multi-component products should be minimized to promote disassembly and value retention. So if you have a product that is manufactured by using multiple types of materials, say, you know, for example, automobiles typically are manufactured by using metal, rubber, two, three different kinds of plastics, maybe wood, and so on. So there is a diversity of material. The problem with that is when the product is not usable anymore, it is very difficult to recover these materials and treat them or manage them separately. So if you want to separate different kind of plastics from metal, and if you are able to do that efficiently, that will obviously increase the rate of recycling. But if you have a lot of diversity in your product, then the separation becomes more difficult, and that reduces the possibility of recycling or value retention. So whenever you are designing something, try to reduce material diversity. Try to get the product manufactured or designed such that you are using as few types of materials as possible, because that will help in managing the product after it is used for disassembly and value retention. The next principles, I will not go in details, but the principle 10 talks about design of products, processes and systems. These must include integration and interconnectivity with available energy and material flows. So this could be things like energy and mass integration in chemical engineering. Principle 11 says that products, processes and systems should be designed for performance in commercial afterlife. And the final principle says that design should be based on renewable and readily available inputs. So many of these principles have overlap with the principles of green engineering, and the American Chemical Society website that I mentioned, it also has a lot of information about green engineering principles, including examples of green engineering. So I will encourage you to look at that website for more examples of these various principles of green engineering. Before I close, let me give you some examples of how simple ideas can be used to manufacture products that incorporate the principle of green engineering. So this particular picture is about a pot-in-pot refrigerator. So this was developed in African countries, and this was developed to provide some basic level of cooling. So it doesn't work like an electricity operated refrigerator, but it provides some cooling. So the way it works is that you have two pots, one smaller pot which is kept inside a larger pot, and the space in between is filled with sand. So you can see here, this is sand, this is the smaller pot, this is the larger pot, and the sand is always kept wet, and this whole assembly is kept in a container where air is flown, so it is open to air. So this works actually similar to the matka that we have to cool water. This is evaporative cooling principle, but you have water that is continuously added, So this air will come in, it will remove some of the moisture from the sand, and because of the evaporative cooling, this space will be cooled, and therefore you will get some temperature reduction. And because you have water that is continuously being added, this sand will always be kept wet, and therefore this process will go on. So this is a product that is designed based on using local material. It doesn't require any energy. It requires only water and some kind of system to make sure that air is flowing across this pot. So this is an example of simple green engineering based design. Some other examples are also given here. So this particular picture on the right is for a detergent that works in cold water. So one of the issues with conventional liquid detergents is that you need to warm water in order to operate, in order to ensure that the washing is more efficient, and in order you need energy to increase the temperature of water, which means which is not desirable, because this energy typically comes from electricity in a washing machine, and electricity production will lead to emissions. So both Ariel and Tide have come up with detergents that work at lower temperature. So turn to 30, Ariel, it works at 30 degrees Celsius. Similarly, cold water, Tide works with cold water instead of warm water. So obviously, in order to make these products, these companies would have had to invest in looking at the basic chemistry and coming up with formulations that work as efficiently as in hot water. But by designing this product, they are actually ensuring that heating is avoided, and therefore the whole process of washing is more energy efficient. The other example is, the second example here is also related to detergents. Earlier we used to have detergents that had to be directly added to the washing machine, but subsequently these companies figured out a way to manufacture detergent concentrates. So basically, in earlier days, you would have a detergent which came with water. It was a solution of water and the detergent, and you have to add it as is. But subsequently, they started selling detergent concentrates. Now, what is the advantage? Because you have a concentrate, the size of the container goes down, because if you want to have 30 washes, then in earlier case you would need a solution of water and a detergent that can be used for 30 washes, and obviously the quantity will be higher, the volume will be higher. But because now you have a concentrate, you can have smaller containers, so that consumer or the user can add water on his own, and because the containers are smaller, you have lesser transport requirement, lesser storage requirement, and all those benefits. The material requirement also goes down, because you need to manufacture fewer containers, so the plastic consumption goes down. So all these examples are there. This particular example is very interesting. It's about the aluminium cans that we have. So if you look at it from fluid mechanics perspective, the container should be strong enough to handle the liquid pressure that is generated. So inside you have liquid, and therefore there will be pressure generated on the walls. Now, based on the fluid mechanics principle, you expect that the pressure at the bottom will be higher, because the liquid column has some height, and therefore the pressure at the top will be lower than the pressure at the bottom. And the thickness of that particular container should be such that it is able to handle this pressure. What we currently have is that the container is made up of constant metal of constant same cross section or same thickness. So at the top also you have the same thickness, at the bottom also you have the same thickness, and the thickness is such that you can handle the worst case of pressure, which is often at the bottom. But you can probably have a situation or a design where the container is thicker at the bottom and thinner at the top, because at the top the pressure due to liquid column or liquid inside is not so high. So you probably don't need such a thick wall. Here you need a thicker wall. So you can have a metal which has higher thickness here, lower thickness here, and use that to manufacture the can. Now obviously this is going to be much more complicated from manufacturing standpoint. It's much easier to have a metal plate which is of uniform thickness and you just turn it and manufacture the aluminium can, or you mold it into manufacturing can or aluminium can. But this is one example of how a novel design can be thought of. So those were the principles of green engineering. Before I talk about the sustainable engineering principles, let me again emphasize the fact that not all principles may be relevant for the design problem that you are handling. Maybe only some of the principles are relevant, the rest are not relevant. You can also have situations where there are trade-offs. So in order to meet one principle, you are compromising on another principle. So maybe in order to increase material, maybe in order to increase energy efficiency, you are using material that is hazardous. So there is a conflict between the two principles of green engineering. In such cases, you have to use your domain expertise and make a conscious choice. So it may not be possible to meet all the design principles of green engineering, and then you have to, in such cases, you have to prioritize. Maybe you have to do some quantification and really quantify what is the level of hazard or what is the level of energy efficiency I'm achieving, and make a decision based on that. The principles of sustainable engineering are, again, there is a lot of overlap between green engineering and sustainable engineering principles. The key difference here is that the sustainable engineering principles acknowledge that sustainability has human dimensions. And therefore, if you look at the statements of sustainable engineering principles, they sound similar to the green engineering principles, but there is a social component or human component. And this is highlighted here. So in the second principle, for example, it talks about conserve and improve natural ecosystems while protecting human health and well-being. So going back to the first few lectures of this course, we have talked about human well-being and how it is connected to sustainability. So the sustainable engineering principles acknowledge that connection. Some of the other principles are similar to what we had in green engineering. For example, use life cycle thinking in engineering activities, or ensure that all material and energy inputs and outputs are inherently safe and benign as much as possible. The seventh principle also incorporates some social dimension. So it says that develop and apply engineering solutions while being cognizant of local geography, aspirations and cultures. So these kind of words or terms were not there in the green chemistry and green engineering principles. Similarly, the last principle says that actively engage communities and stakeholders in development of engineering solutions. So the point here is that as you move from green engineering to green to sustainable engineering principles, there is greater appreciation for the social dimension of sustainability. So I will not discuss these principles in detail, but there is material available online to get more information. So the key learning outcomes of this module, this as well as the previous modules, are we have discussed the green engineering principles. These provide guidelines. You may need to consider multiple green engineering principles. There may be trade-offs between different principles, and you have to make a decision based on your domain expertise. And sustainable engineering principles consider social aspects of sustainability. Thank you.